So today we are discussing this data import chapter 11 from R4DS book. I want to start with the popular data format only. Rather than going by the structure of the book chapter, I have tweaked the schedule. Generally, the easiest to import data is R data format, which is native to R. R data or RDS format. Then simple, most portable or most shareable is a comma separated value, which we encounter most in data science or even in my field finance. We generally share it in CSV format only so that they can import it in other statistical packages as well. Then sometimes I have encountered text files also. The data is tabulated, but they are separated by tab or some other delimiter. Then spreadsheet packages like Microsoft Excel or OpenOffice formats. Then there are databases. In data science, we will encounter this kind of databases also, Oracle, MySQL or NoSQL kind of data sets also, which need to be processed in R. And other packages like Stata, SAS or SPSS, they also have their native format or proprietary formats like SAV in case of SPSS. And then there are other methods. The most basic of them is the base R. For example, read table, which is the parent function, and the special case is read CSV. In this book, we will learn more about reader package, which is also incorporated into RStudio. And most common function is read CSV, read underscore CSV, which we will be learning deeply. Functions from read Excel package. Read Excel is also developed by Hedley Wickham only. So it shares a lot of arguments with the read CSV function also. And this read Excel function can read read underscore Excel. This function can read both XLS and XLSX data formats. This fread function from data.table package is also very convenient. Just yesterday I have used it. And believe me, it is very convenient and even fast too. But the problem is that the output is data.table, not table or not even data frame. Data table is also considered an enhancement of basic data frame, but we will have to convert it into table and we will lose some functionality as well. So it is not so convenient when we are using tidyverse. And then there is Haven package. It is also inbuilt into RStudio. This package can read data from other statistical packages like read underscore SAS, read underscore SPSS or read underscore Stata. This function can read data from other statistical packages. The most common thing that we are going to learn is read underscore CSV from reader package. The most important argument in this function is file and the path to this file. Other arguments, column names, call names, and column types. Whenever I have used it, I have always appended these two arguments. Local is also important. We will have to deal with in later slides. NA also, and some of the slides will be dealt to this guess underscore max, because that can create some problems. And then this chapter shows how to enter CSV file inline. That means within R also we can create a CSV file and that will be read into R. If we enter this kind of code, read underscore CSV into bracket colon A comma B comma C, notice that there is no comma after C. That means these three are column heads. and thereafter 1, 2, 3, the numerical items are data enter into rows, and ABC is the column name. The output will be shown like this. It's a table, and A, B, and C are column names, and the other are data. There is another way also. Pay attention to this backslash n. That means new line. So 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6 are new lines only, but there is no column name because we have set column names equal to false. And when we set it like that, reader will automatically create variable names on its own, x1, x2, x3. And when we saw this call names, there can be three kind of arguments here. Call names value can be three of the things. Either true, then the first row in the CSV file will be considered as headers, the column names. If we set it false, all the data will be considered as data only, not the column names. Or it can be a character vector, C into bracket, whatever the names you want to set it. We will go to exercise. The question one, what is the function you would use when you want to read a file where fields are separated with a vertical line? If we go to, can you read this one? Can you share this? Can you see this in RStudio screen?
No, I'm not able to see it.
Okay, let me share it. If we go to help in this read underscore CSV, ID was not loaded. In that case, we can see that read underscore delim is the parent function, and read CSV is a special case of it. So here, when the question is, what function would you use to read a file where fields are separated with vertical line? In that case, we cannot read a read underscore CSV function. We will have to use this parent function, read underscore delim. Then the question is, apart from file, skip, and comment, what are the other arguments which are common between read CSV and read TSV? TSV is tab separated file. Actually, both share many arguments. If we see this help only, we get to know all these functions and all the arguments. So there are column names, column types, local, NA, quoted NA, quote trim, and whole lot of function, lot of arguments which are common between these two functions. The next is, what are the most important arguments in read FWF, that is fixed width file? In those files, apart from the file name, the position, column position is most important argument. I must confess, I have cheated here. I had to see the solution because I thought the file name should be most important here. Then one question is, can we sometimes the strings in CSV file contain comma. To prevent them from causing problems, they need to be surrounded by quote marks. By default, it will assume that the quoting character is in double inverted comma only. But what argument will read CSV will you need to specify this kind of text? Then also we will have to use read delim only, and we will have to specify that quotation mark is single inverted comma, not the double inverted comma. And then it will be evaluated like this. X and Y are variable name, and A and B. One is here in X column, and A and B will be displayed in Y column. Now, there are five problematic cases in the next exercise. In the first two, if you see, A and B are column names, if you understood the read CSV format so far. But when we see the data, the 1, 2, 3, there are three columns, but headers are only two. So what happens in this case is, the third column will automatically be skipped. See, like this. The 3 and 6 are skipped in the output. Same thing happens here, A, B, C. In the second code also, there are three headers, A, B, and C. But in when we come to data, there is only 1, 2. They will be displayed, but 4 will be skipped. In the second row, there will be one NA in the C column. In the third case, see, there is an NA in the B column also, because there are more headers than the data itself. When it comes to fourth, both will be characters. See here, there is an NA in first column, which will and one in the first row. So the A column has one and NA. So the character is the most least restrictive out of this. So therefore, this table will have column A as character. And in column B also, there is one B, which is a string. And therefore, B will also be considered as string only, even though it has two, which is numeric item. And in the last one, see, both are, the column name itself is A and B. There is semicolon, not column, not comma here. So there is only one column, and that is also character because it is having a semicolon inside the data. Probably the data entry operator would consider it, wanted to enter it as numeric, but it is not happening here because there is semicolon instead of comma. Then this book chapter talks about parse function, which are the backbones of this reader. This is how the data enters into different vectors, and these vectors combine to create a table. Parse and parse logical, parse integer, parse date, and there are all kinds of parse functions. And in all these functions, local is an important argument. we have not discussed it yet, even when we talked about read underscore CSV. But still, we will have some exercises to clarify about this. Local will control the date and time formats, how the date and time, date name, month name, etc. are displayed, even the time zones, number and formatting, even the encoding part. What happens when we try to set decimal mark and grouping mark on the same character? For example, we want to set decimal mark and grouping mark on comma or semicolon. Then R will throw an error. It is not possible to set the same thing as decimal mark and grouping mark. If we set decimal mark equal to comma, then automatically dot will become grouping mark. And if we set decimal mark equal to dot, then grouping mark will automatically be set to comma. That is by default. Then we have not discussed date format and time format in local, but they change the default date and time formats, how they are displayed. For example, in European countries, it may be displayed differently. We can see the vignette of reader package to see how it is possible, how it is actually used in reader package. One exercise was also asked to create our own local. I have not created it, but it is possible to create here. If we see local, it will show two points here. Create local either in reader or stringy package. We will have to see it here in reader package only. We can change the argument here and create our own local using this. What is the difference between read CSV and read CSV2? In fact, in base R also, there are read.csv and read.csv2. The difference is that in European countries particularly, comma is used at decimal point and the separator or delimiter is semicolon. So in that case, this is a special case of CSV. So we will use read underscore CSV2 in this kind of files. What are the most common encoding in Europe, in Asia or in other countries? I have not checked out all of them, but see, UTF-8 is the most common and ASCII encoding was the earliest one. We can also check within RStudio which one are supported. If we go to global option, we can see there also global option, code, and saving. It shows different kinds of encoding available within RStudio. ISO 8859, UTF-8, ASCII. And if we see show all encoding, then it will show many of the encoding. Even Macintosh or IBM kind of encoding are also available. ISO encoding. Then there are Macintosh, MS, that is Microsoft specific. And I don't know what the USC or other, then there are Windows and XISCII, XMAC. There are different series of encodings which we can see in RStudio itself. Then one exercise asks us to generate correct format string to parse each of the following dates and time. I have cheated there also, January 1, then we will have to see. And yes, I had to see R Markdown for this. R Markdown cookbook specifically shows this date and time formats. Percentage B, I have used it even for here. So this is not specific to our studio or only this reader package. This is used across R, base R also. Percentage B, that is full name of month. Percentage D, D is for date. If we say small d, then only short date. And percentage Y, if it is small y, then only last two digits of the year will be shown. Capital Y, that means all the four digit year will be shown. And when there is no dash between them, see, it will be separated by comma here. So that's how this date and time is displayed in R, base R also. Then we will come to problem cases or how the inside of the reader works. Basically, when we saw read underscore CSV, there was a concept guess underscore max. That means how many rows will reader see to guess the type of data it has. By default, it is 1000 rows. When we give a CSV file to reader, it will show the first 1000 rows and check which type of data sits in one particular column of that data set. If there are only NAs in first 1000 observation, then reader will think it is a logical kind of data. But if there is another kind of data at 1001th row, then it will have a problem. And the reader will think it is logical, but actually it is not. At the end of data import, when we see summary function or summary DF, then it will show something problem. In that case, we will have to check it and solve it column by column. Solve problem related to one column first, then go to the next column, then third column, etc. And there is GUI way also to import data. See, if you go to file, import data set, then also you will see most common arguments here. You will see some, I have already created this sample data. Yes. And most common arguments are also shown here in checkbox. So we don't have to specify it in, we don't have to remember the syntax also. But the problem with this kind of GUI data import is that this import happens in console. We don't get to get the code inside your R script or R markdown. So we'll have to copy and paste the code into your R markdown file or R script file if you want to share it. Otherwise, you can do your process and you can keep the data and your output with you, but you cannot share it with others. If you compile that, it will throw error and you will have to check right from the beginning. Then there are some more problems too. As we saw, reader will read first 1000 rows only. If it has only text, reader will assume that the data is only character. If there are NAs in between also, then reader will think it is logical. So after data import, please read summary of your data and you will get to know if it is encoded as character or if the data is has NAs after 1000, then the summary will show mean as NA. Then you will know that there is you have encountered some error. Otherwise, if there are only numbers in first 1000 rows, you will think that it has been entered as numeric or integer only. it doesn't happen sometime that way. And if such problem exists after your data import completes, solve them column by column only. That's it from my side today.
Thank you, Malik. That was very useful.
I have actually tried to incorporate everything we have learned, like project-oriented workflow, and I have even tried to use R Markdown to create IO slide presentation.
Yeah. And you had a sample data set also. So, yeah, that was great.
That was actually taken from Damodar Gujarati's book.
Okay.
Basic econometrics.
Okay. Are you an economist?
I'm actually enrolled for a PhD. But because of my cancer, that I was halted in 2018 only. I'm now considering going back to campus to complete it now.
Okay. And PhD in what?
PhD in finance.
Okay.
It was basically financial econometrics. Banking and regulation kind of issues.
Oh, wonderful.
Thank you, Malik. It was really informative and descriptive. I enjoyed your session today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, for the next week, I am a little tied up to do the next presentation. If there is nobody, I think we can skip the next week. That wouldn't be a problem. What do you guys think?
I don't mind it.
Yeah, I think that's okay. We have been doing well in terms of going on without taking a break. So maybe just take a break.
Yeah, that is true. okay, then I think next week we'll be skipping it. I'll just put it on Slack that we won't be having it next week so that the others also will know. And yes. We can decide later how we'll go about it.
Definitely.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah, bye.